Majesty, worship His majesty. On accessible, you are hidden from our eyes. You inhabit the high and lofty places, but yet you condescend to dwell with those who are of a contrite and humble heart. We thank you, Your Majesty, that you inhabit the praises of your people. We have lived long enough to learn that when praises go up, blessings come down. And so we are just here today to praise your holy name. But we are also here to uplift that name that is above every name, the majestic name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. We're grateful that he is a heart fixer and a mind regulator. We're grateful that he is our doctor in a sick room and our lawyer in a courtroom. We're grateful that he is our bridge over troubled waters. We have come to say thank you for salvation, for his breakthrough at Bethlehem. But even more importantly, we come to praise him for that hill called Calvary, and to praise his holy name for saving us from the guttermost to the uttermost. Have your way in this service, O God. Lift our hearts to the heights of glory. Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts cause heaven to smile. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, we praise you and thank you. Amen, amen. And amen.
You may be seated. Good morning, friends.
Good morning.
Oh, that does not sound like you're a friend. Good morning, friends.
Good morning,
good morning, good morning. It is indeed a privilege to welcome you today. But, as we say at Huntington, this is a community business. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. You're going to stand?
Amen.
Come on, stand up, stand up. We're going to do a little exercise this morning. I want you to practice with me. Do what I'm doing. What am I doing? Come on, do it with me. What am I doing? I'm practicing, all right? That's it. How does that feel? It feels good? Okay, so this morning, as the praise team sings, smile, everybody, smile, I'm going to ask you to welcome each other. Now, these are the conditions. You're going to hug someone, but not the person you came with this morning. You have to hug somebody else, okay? Does everybody understand? Okay, so if it means that you're going to have to move around, you're going to have to move around, okay? So you're going to hug someone that you did not come with. You're going to welcome them this morning. Amen?
Yeah.
All right, praise team, smile, everybody, smile. And we're going to greet each other in Jesus' name.
Smile, everybody, smile.
Let us breathe, come on.
all stand for our opening hymn, which is number 229. If you have your phones handy, you should be able to pull it up if you have a hymnal in your phone, but I will help along with the words. All hail the power of Jesus.
Children and parents that are here with us, they're not your kids. They are a gift from God that God known you for a while. Children ultimately belong to God. They are given to parents, and parents are to raise them in a manner that will honor God in all ways. Christian education schools exist to help parents. You're not alone. We are here to help you fulfill that big responsibility. And I'm pretty sure that if I was to ask parents that are sitting right now, is it hard to raise kids? I'm pretty sure you'll say, oh yes, it is very hard. But we are here to tell you, you're not alone. We are here to work hand in hand with you. True Christian education provides the proper goal to which students are to be appointed, because the teaching in our school is based on the scripture, which makes it thoroughly equipped for every good work. And I'm pretty sure you will agree with me on this, that we are living in the days where moral values have been lost. And as parents, I am a mother of three, and I do have that concern as well. What is happening out there? Thankfully, parents, people that are here with us, we do have an alternative. As children are educated to think God's thoughts after Him, we're laying the foundation for a better culture as our children become adults and prayerfully and wisely apply God-centered thinking in their families and also in their cultures. We should remember that ultimate goal of learning should be to understand more of our God as our Creator, as our Redeemer, and to reflect that understanding in our personal lives. And you know, I would like to share that at South Bay Junior Academy, we do provide a high quality Center Christ program, a high accredited academic program. We do also have a foreign program beginning from pre-K to eighth grade. We do have gym, and also we do have a music program. And my appeal to you members, Church of God, that for Christian education, there is no substitute. And you know what? I want to invite you to repeat this with me. Christian education, there's no substitute. And I want you to keep that in your heart. We need to support God's way of training our kids. He left this installed here in this world, and we need to take advantage of it. Okay, so let's all believe in Christian education. May God bless you.
Greetings again and happy Sabbath to you. It was my joy to address you during our presentation at Whispering Pines School, at our Sabbath school. And again, to stand, I was asked to stand in the place of Mrs. Mitchell, the principal of the Academy, our Greater New York Academy, and she was unable to make it. But my name is Shirley Ann Lawrence, the principal of the Whispering Pines School. It's an honor to serve in this capacity, serving our young people, building up the kingdom of God. I want to tell you why I have and will and always will choose Christian education. I am a product of Seventh-day Adventist Christian education my entire life. And so I speak what, I live what I speak, I work where I believe. It's all ingrained, it's part of me, it's in the fabric of who I am. And I'll tell you, it was the commitment of my parents for their children to experience Christian education. So my siblings, along with myself, we all went through the entire process. I want to tell you about some other committed parents, just like my parents. They sitting right here in this audience. I want to tell you about the Martins. They just joined us this year. Three children. They travel a distance to get to the school, but they do it. It's called commitment. I want to tell you about the Simpsons. They're here today. Four, Mrs. Simpson, I see you up there, and her four children. They travel 100 miles a day to get to school. I'm talking about commitment. I want to tell you about the other parents, and if you are here, I asked you to identify yourself earlier, but if you could just wave again. They're right there. They're all around. They live in Queens. They live in many parts of on the island, Long Island, Brooklyn. They travel. I want to tell you about Arnaldo. Arnaldo's children, three of them, attended the public school for many years, and for 3 years, Arnaldo has come to my office, knocked at my door. He said, "Is there a bus, Ms. Lawrence? Is there a bus? Is there a bus that can bring my children from Far Rock away?" And we tried several options. This year, he decided my wife is going to leave her job, and we're going to take that leap of faith. And today, his children, three of them, attend the Whispering Pines School. It's called commitment. Why do parents go this length? Why? It costs. It really does. But it yields a great dividend. Because what does it profit a man to gain the world? Lose his own soul. Let me read for you a passage from my favorite author. We want to all understand how the soul is destroyed. It is not that God sends out a decree that man shall not be saved. He does not throw a darkness before the eyes which cannot be penetrated. But man at first resists a motion of the Spirit of God, and having once resisted, it is less difficult to do so the second and the third and fourth time. Our children are up against forces, the evil one, in an unprecedented way, such as never been seen before. What we thought were challenges when we were younger, oh, it's at a different level now. And so we must do whatever it takes to help to guard the minds and the souls of our young people. It's going to cost, but there are committed men and women, parents, who will go the full cost. They will go for everything. They'll go the extra mile just to make sure, to ensure that their child will see Jesus' face. We want you to continue to support us. We want you to pray for us. And if you are a parent of a school-age child, as my colleague Mrs. Thomas shared, we are in partnership for Christian education. Whispering Pines is open to accepting your application. We are about at capacity right now, but we don't mind having an open a waiting list, okay? But despite that, we want to ensure that we deliver quality Christian education. We do not take for granted that we are preparing our young people for citizenship in this world. So they are prepared for state tests. They perform exceptionally well. Amen. They are presented with a rigorous curriculum in the core subjects. And as we presented in our Sabbath school, we present as well a dual language program in Korean and Spanish, an extended day to 4 p.m. So that we can cover a full curriculum in all subject areas. We bless the Lord for your commitment and for our parents and for staying on your knees on our behalf, because soon and very soon, he's coming and we want to see him. God bless you.
I went to my school because I get to learn about Christ and I get a great education. My experience in this school, it's a fun experience because all the teachers and students are very close. When you're growing up, especially when you're in high school, you encounter so many things at once, and then you're trying to also stay focused and do something with your life. I feel it's harder if you're not surrounded by people who care.
I think it's better to go to Greater New York Academy because the teacher cares more. So if the teacher cares more, they care more about your education too.
Every time I would fail and stuff, I would like get frustrated. The teacher would come and say, "Don't worry, you can do this, you got this."
The teachers here, they're helping me try to build my relationship with God more and more every day.
And it was encouraging to go. My faith is home to pray because to keep going. And that is something that we need that you can't find anywhere else apart from a Christian environment.
Help us to remember that we're coming soon and
loving
you and praying. Amen.
The Bible says that we should help one another. And when you bless a child of Christ, Christ will bless you back.
I have seen young people who really want to come to Adventist schools because they have seen all the living testimonies that walk out of Greater New York Academy every day, and they're like, "Oh, they're doing great. I want to do great things as well."
I'm one of those kids that I can say that if it wasn't for other people's funds, I wouldn't be in Christian education. I wouldn't be in a place that I am right now.
If you really want to set the foundation and change a child's life, give to Christian education. Whether it's $1, $100, $1,000, whatever you can give to help set a student up so their life can be changed.
Think about it in the long. If you were in that situation as a child and someone was thinking about helping you out, you want the donation as quickly as possible, or as much as possible.
When you send a child to a Seventh-day Adventist school, they will feel positive, you will reap rich rewards from your investment, and you will have impacted a life. And that child, maybe that child will never know that you gave, but in your heart, you will know that you touched someone's life, and that's a meaningful experience.
Your child belongs in an Adventist school. Contact the Greater New York Conference to learn how you can support our schools.
Thank you for including senior citizens in this program. God be the glory.
Yes.
Initially, we'd like to say the only reason Mrs. Romy is not here right now, she has two appointments. She's rushing from the Grand Concourse Church, but she wants to be here for Divine Worship Hour. So please pray that she has traveling mercies from the Bronx to Huntington. Amen. Initially, we'd like to applaud Dr. Benoit and the joint effort of the Huntington and Antioch Assembly Adventist Churches for this joint effort focusing on student scholarships. To God be the glory. out of 180 congregations, some of them, not all of them, but some of them, including this district, is focusing on eternal values, focusing on our children. I'd also like to recognize that two Sabbaths ago was a special time in Dr. Benoit's life. He is now an ordained Seventh-day Adventist pastor. And just as important, he's an alumnus of Greater New York Academy. You know, brothers and sisters, Adventist education, just like the Adventist Church, we're a movement of destiny. And we are answerable to God for the management of His property, His children. Just three brief observations. Point number one, this is from Councils on Education, page 202. Ellen White says this, let all share the expense. Let the church see those who ought to receive the benefits are attending the school. Poor families should be assisted. So what you are doing today is extremely noble. We cannot call ourselves true missionaries if we neglect those who are at our very doors, who are at the most critical age and who need our aid to secure knowledge and experience that will fit them for the service of God. So attending an Adventist school is a sacred responsibility. All of us have to share it. Point number two, Dr. Roger Dudley, several years ago, wrote a very poignant book focusing on Adventist education. The name of his book was, Why Our Seventh-day Adventist Teenagers Are Leaving the Seventh-day Adventist Church. He states that the third most significant variable in determining whether or not your children remain faithful, lifelong Seventh-day Adventists is whether or not you put them in an Adventist school. And the more years in an Adventist school, the greater the difference. Number three, as important as a strong spiritual emphasis may be, our schools also offer quality academics. According to the Cognitive Genesis study, and you know what? I'm very proud about this. In the history of America, the largest study by private school education was conducted by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It had over 50,000 students from over 800 Adventist schools. And this is what they found. The longer students stayed in the Adventist school system, the more they gained in achievement and ability. When God asks every single one of us, I hope that child goes to an Adventist school, because when that child gets older, he's got strong lungs. Well, she has strong lungs. She has strong lungs. All right. God asks us the one important question in relationship to our children, where is the flock that was given thee, thy beautiful flock? May every single one of us be able to say we did all that we possibly could do on behalf of our children. Now I'm just going to share a very personal testimony in closing. Many of you know that my son died in Iraq. He was the head medic for his entire division on February 27, 2007. But he had a six-week leave, and as one of his first stops, he went back to his elementary school and thanked every single one of his teachers for the impact that they had upon his life. Surely, when he made this statement, he was given the opportunity of serving in a medical clinic. He turned that down so that he said, I'd rather be on the front lines where I can save more lives. Adventist education was one of the components that made a big difference in his life. And so parents, if you're on the fence, your children will be impacted by two elements, not just academic excellence, but by the fact that Jesus Christ is shaping and molding the lives of every single one of our boys and girls. And so your generous contribution today towards student scholarships could be the difference between a child going to public school versus a child that just might make that decision to follow Jesus. To God be the glory for Seventh-day Adventist Christian education.
Just before our pathfinders and ushers come forward to collect the offering that you have brought, you know, we at the Huntington and Antioch District, we are privileged to be part of a two-school district, the Whispering Pine and South Bay Junior Academy. And folks, to be very honest with you, the purpose of this program is very simple and is twofold. First of all, highlight the fact that your children, our children, needs to be in our schools. And second, try to make provide the means by which some of those who are unable or those who are struggling to get to our schools can actually make it there to our schools. So what you are going to give here today is of absolute importance. We're going to ask you to be sacrificial even, because the offering that we're going to collect will go towards those two schools. Now, we recognize that there are many of you, particularly the millennials among us, you may not have any cash on you. Well, guess what? We have made provision. We have made provision. Now, my PowerPoint presentation is not working too well, but I'm going to display what I have on the screen anyhow. But it should be in the back of your program. It's very simple. If you text the word GIVE to the following number, 347-708-8256, immediately, within a second or two, you will receive a text back. There will be a link. You will click on the link. There's a couple of information that you will put, and then you'll have the option of giving either by credit card or by check. We are begging you, and I'm using my words carefully, we are begging you, because this is something worth begging for. Please give generously. Give sacrificially. And I trust that the Lord will pour down a blessing like never before. May God bless you all. Let us pray. Let us pray. Father, we thank you so very much for loving us the way you do. We thank you for this awesome gift that you have given us. I just love the way that the servant of God placed it. She says, you did not give us the best gift in heaven. No, but you give us all of heaven in one gift, Jesus Christ our Lord. And so today, Father, we are asking that you will help us to be as generous as we possibly can, as we invest in our children, not just for now, but for eternity, because eternity is at stake. Thank you for what you've done and what you will continue to do in our lives and in theirs. We ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Forever, forever. Thank you.
with me, stay with me, stay with me as we get ready to pray. I'm going to invite everyone to stand with me as we call upon our great and mighty God. Here we are in His presence, bowing before Him. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, we come in this moment to call upon You, our God, our God. Father, we are thankful for this, the day in which You have made for us to pause from the busyness of life, to come to worship You, to come to honor You. We ask, O God, that today You will accept the worship we bring before You. Father, we have come from the east, the west, the north, and the south, thanking You for bringing us in this place of worship. You know, as I sat here, Lord, and I think about how good You are, when we look at the laws of our land, how they're trying to take worship out of school, and here we are in a school worshiping You, calling upon Your holy name. Amen. What a mighty God You are. Father, today we are here to celebrate Christian education, dear Lord. Father, we live in a world now where everything seems to be going haywire, and we need this kind of education for our boys and our girls, dear Lord. It was just last night in our worship session at home, dear Lord, my young nephew said to me in worship that he heard of someone, dear Lord, in the public school selling weed to a next person that was witnessed. These are the things that are happening in our schools, oh Father. We need a Christian education. Father, if there's a time in which we, Your people, need You, it is now. So we ask, O Father, that You will come divinely close to us. Draw near to us, dear Lord, as we draw near to You. We pray for these institutions, dear Lord. We pray for the principals of these schools, the teachers of these schools, who are trying their very best, dear Lord, to promote Christ and Christ alone in our schools. We ask, O God, that You will bless them day in and day out, dear Lord. Some are making extreme sacrifices, dear Lord, leaving their jobs, traveling distance, dear Lord, just to get to a safe place of school for their boys and girls. We ask, O God, that You would bless them, dear Lord. May they continue to make these sacrifices for their young ones, dear Lord. Bless them in a very special way. And as they live their life, dear Lord, may the life that they live, dear Lord, when they go out into the community and into the world will not see them, dear Lord, but they will see the Christ in them. Bless them, O God. We pray for every single person standing here this morning, dear Lord. Father, You know their need. You know what it is that they are in need of at this moment. Father, You can provide, dear Lord. We ask that in Your divine will that You will bless them today. Provide for what it is that they are in need of, dear Lord. And when they leave, dear Lord, may they give You thanks and praise. Father, You have sent to us Your manservant, dear Lord. We are thankful that You have brought him here safely to us, dear Lord. You have a word through him for us today, O God. Help us, dear Lord, to hear, thus saith the Lord. And when we leave from this place, help us not to keep what we have heard to ourselves, dear Lord, but to go out into the world and to share what we have learned with others, dear Lord, to let them know that there is a God who sits high and who looks on the needs of his children. Father, we ought to be going out, dear Lord, doing what You have asked us to do, and that is to spread the good news of the gospel. Bless us now, we ask. Bless our pastor, dear Lord, Heavenly B. Benoit. Father, Your humble servant, we ask, O God, that You'll continue to anoint this man, dear Lord. Be with him in a marked way, dear Lord. You see him, dear Lord. You see his challenges, dear Lord. We give them to You, dear Lord. Help him to continue to trust in You, knowing that You are able and You will see him through. So again, O God, we thank You for this, Your holy Sabbath day. Help us to worship You like no other day. Help us to worship You, dear Lord, and to give You the praise in which You deserve, dear Lord. Thank You for hearing our prayers. And Lord, please forgive us of our sins. And when Jesus shall come again,
save us in your everlasting kingdom. Not only us, O God, but those who we have labored for, our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers, dear Lord. Save them, dear Lord. This we humble ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, church. And aren't you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen?
Amen.
Come on, put your hands together for Jesus, because he brought you out this far. He brought you to see another day. Hallelujah. He brought you to wake up this morning in your right mind. Hallelujah. We got to thank. There's so much going on in the world today, as you can see on the news, and it's sad. There's children dying at young ages, there's families being torn apart, there's countries being destroyed. When you watch the news, it'll make you feel as if there is no God. Have mercy. But how many know that today we serve a risen Savior, hallelujah, who is still in the world today? I know that he is living no matter what men may say. Praise God. But be overjoyed because of what God has done for me. I don't know your testimony, but come on, give him praise this morning, because you know what he's brought you through. Amen. So everyone in here today, I invite you, let the Spirit of God reign over you, for you, only you know alone what God has done for you. So open your mouth and let us worship. Amen. I love you, Lord. Let it.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I invite you to open your Bibles to Deuteronomy 6. I will be reading Deuteronomy.
Sábado, hermanos, les invito a abrir sus Biblias en el libro de Daniel, capítulo 6, versículo 4-9. Entonces los gobernadores y sátrapas buscaban ocasión para acusar a Daniel en lo relacionado al reino, mas no podían hallar ocasión alguna o falta, porque él era fiel y ningún vicio ni falta fue hallado en él. Entonces dijeron a aquellos hombres: No hallaremos contra este Daniel ocasión alguna para acusarle si no la hallamos contra él en relación con la ley de su Dios. Entonces esos gobernadores y sátrapas se juntaron delante del rey y le dijeron así: Rey Dario, para siempre vive. Todos los gobernadores del reino, magistrados, sátrapas, príncipes y capitanes han acordado por consejo que promulgues un edicto real y lo confirmes que cualquiera que en ese espacio de 30 días te mande petición de cualquier dios o hombre fuera de ti, hoy rey, se ha echado en el foso de los leones. Ahora, hoy rey, confirma el edicto y fírmalo para que no pueda ser revocado conforme a la ley de Media y de Persia, la cual no puede ser abrogada. Firmó, pues, el rey Darío el edicto y la prohibición.
I'm going to be reading Daniel chapter 6, verses 8 and 9 in Hebrew. "그러므로 왕이시여, 이제 경영을 내려 저서에 와인을 찍어서 어쩔 수 없는 인디아와 베르시아의 법으로 정하십시오. 그래서 다리에서 왕은 저서에 어인을 찍어 금령을 공포하였다. 다리에서 역전 발절로 보존하소. 아멘."
62nd chaplain of the United States Senate. In addition to opening the Senate, each day in prayer, Chaplain Black provides counseling and spiritual care for senators, their families, and staff, a combined constituency of over 7,000 people. He also meets with senators about spiritual and moral issues, assists with research on theological and biblical questions, and facilitates discussion and reflection small groups among senators and staff. He also conducts marriage enrichment counseling and officiates at weddings, funerals, and memorial services. Chaplain Black initiates the participates in special and seasonal observances, leads interdenominational prayer gatherings, and cultivates relationship with local clergy and leaders of humanitarian agencies. Prior to Capitol Hill, the Chaplain Black served in the U.S. Navy for over 27 years, ending his distinguished career as the Chief of Navy Chaplain. Chaplain Black is a native of Baltimore, Maryland, and alumnus of Oakwood College, Andrews University, North Carolina Central University, Palmer Theological Seminary, South Virginia University, and Lyon International University. In addition to earning a Master's of Arts degree in Divinity, Counseling, and Management, he has received a doctorate degree in Ministry and a Doctor of Philosophy degree in Psychology. In 2006, he authored his autobiography entitled From the Hood to the Hill, and in 2011, The Blessing of Adversity. Chaplain Black is married to the former Brenda Prasad of St. Petersburg, Florida. They have three sons, Barry II, Brendan, and Bradford. Ladies and gentlemen, after the special selection that will be presented by Mrs. Tatum Small, the next voice you will hear is that of the Chaplain of the United States Senate, Dr. Barry C. Black.
God is so good. After the praise team, I pray to God that my voice holds up for this song.
He's Jehovah Rapha. Yeah.